thank you very much for having me here. Any excuse to come to Goa is a good one, and this is a brilliant one because it's also something close to my heart. In that order, Wendell and fashion. I'm going to tell you very briefly about the Green Room. For those of you who haven't yet read it, it is a must read. I'm not hard selling, I'm just telling you what I believe. When Wendell told me, it was during a fashion week, that Wendell came rushing up the escalator in Delhi and said, you know, I've just signed on, I'm going to do this biography. And it's amazing how enthusiastic everybody is. I said, oh, another designer writing a biography. But when the book came out, I was very, very pleasantly surprised, because here was a designer who knew how to write, and here was a designer who was honest. And a designer who wanted to say what he wanted in the heart. There's no fluff in the Green Room. There's nothing in it that makes you think, ah, this one's pulling a fast one on me. It's honest, it's sincere, it tells the story as it is, and it tells the story of not just his life and the ups and downs, mainly ups, thank God, but also about his entire career in fashion. And from that point of view, somebody who wants to know, have an inside view of what Indian fashion is about, it's a great window. It's a great window. It's not the complete window, because yes, it's Wendell's life and Wendell's career, but it still is a great window to understand what Indian fashion is and how a designer who's true to his soul, who's true to his roots, can make a success, you know, without any posturing. Without going any further, I would like to start, Wendell. Can you see the first slide?
Okay. So I think we start with the first slide, please.
This is the cover of the Green Room. Well, this obviously is showing something that is caught midway. Tell us how you got this cover.
Actually, this was the first show I did in my career on as a solo designer. It was in 1997. And Farooq Chothia, even as celebrity, as famous as he was that time, was in the green room picking the models as they wore the clothes. And we hid this photograph for all these years and then fished it out now for the cover, because it just made so much of sense to have Malaika on the cover, who's been a big part of my life, and then to actually put it in the green room. We must say that the show at the Kala Academy in 1997 was a really big event. We cheated, we actually smuggled bottles of champagne into the back room, which is not allowed. And we had a great time backstage, the models were having a great time, and Farooq captured that, you know, vivacious feel of the green room, and hence we picked this as a cover of the book. Next, please. And in the same room, we had Nayonika Chatterjee, and that is Rani. I think she married Rahul Roy or someone. So, Noina, actually, I knew her from 1989. I met her at a shoot in Bombay, and she was overshadowed by a model called Anu Agarwal in a studio in Bombay. And because she was a dark model, nobody wanted her. But then finally, we made sure that she enjoyed the light as much as any other model did. And she's now over 40 and still modeling. Next, please. And this, the green room for this shoot was actually Jimmy Gazra's house. We took Madhu Sapre at that time. It took us a long time to find muscles that large to cover her breast. We actually finally had to blend two muscles together and kind of paste them to create that image and to create that outfit. But it was in Jimmy Gazra's pool. I do not know if the pool is the same, because I haven't been there since a long time.
I'm going to butt in here and tell you that perhaps the Kala Academy, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Played an equally important role in my own career, just as it played in Wendell's, because his first show was there, and the first Miss India that I participated in as one of the organizers was there. And that was the historic year of 1994, when we had Sushmita and Aishwarya winning the crowns, international crowns, soon after. And I think Goa has always been lucky. For whoever believes in it.
I still remember that Miss India, there was a lot of politicking happening at the backstage because Aishwarya was to get the crown, but there was enough of drama backstage, which I didn't reveal in the green room in my book. But she was being hounded by other models because apparently one of the supermodels at that time, and I can't take her name, her boyfriend was kind of giving Ash the glad eye. And the glad eye continued until the breakup. Okay, next slide please. This was shot by Denzel Sequeira. He's here in the room, in his house in Baikala. At that time, reigning queen of the catwalk, Meher Jessia, wearing a loose garment that she was not very comfortable with. I think Satya can elaborate.
I can tell you a little bit about Meher Jessia. I mean, she was one of our most beautiful Miss Indias at that time. And it was very strange because we were just closing the books for entries. It was 3:30 and we were supposed to close the books at 4, and there's this girl standing next to my table. I was a junior still then. I was a sub-editor. She's standing next to my table. I'm looking at her and saying, who's this pretty girl standing next to me? And then the photographer, Farooq Jasawala, comes up to me and says, where is the editor? So I said, she's inside her room. Said, well, I've got this girl and she wants to enter Miss India. So I went in and I said, Mrs. Patil, there's a girl outside and she wants to enter Miss India. So Mrs. Patil said, well, it's almost 4, forget it, tell her to go back. She should know, she should come on time. I said, she's very pretty. She says, doesn't matter, tell her that she must come on time. Just, I said, come out and look at her. So Mrs. Patil stepped out and the rest is history.
Yeah, she was one of our great iconic models. We go to the next slide, which is actually in 1993, my first collection out of Goa. It was the same time that Satya Saran joined Femina as editor of Femina. And I made that blouse like a chutna, like you know how we weave our coconut leaves for protection against the monsoon. It was made in silk organza. And the first time ever that we used coconut shell embroidery, the first eco collection that went out of Goa. This outfit had a very strange history. One of the things was bought by Rekha, the original, and the second was bought by Aishwarya when she won Miss World. And they both knew that they bought the outfit, and they would, like when they would wear the outfit, they would call each other and say, are you wearing that Wendell Rodrigues outfit? Because I'm wearing it today. And that's the story of this garment. It's all in the green room actually when you read the book. Next please. And this was shot again by Denzel Sequeira in Manori, where the green room became one of the bathrooms in Manori Bell, I think, the hotel. Yeah, am I right, Denzel?
It was the balcony of
Manori. Oh, the balcony of Manori Bell. And I don't think Ash has shown that much leg since her career took off, because it was one of my first asymmetric dresses shot over there. I remember her mother, Brinda, being there and helping her dress up, and I think Cori Walia did the hair and makeup, and it became the invitation card of the first Wendell Rodrigues shop in Goa.
Which takes me back to the time when, in fact, the Mariru picture takes me back to the time when I first came to Goa, and I was here for a shoot, and I happened to, I mean, Rafiq was the photographer, and he said, let's go visit Wendell. I said, Wendell, wow. Let's go. So we went to see Wendell, and Wendell, I'll never forget what I saw. We opened the gate and Wendell was sitting there all by himself. You know, there was music in the background. He had this little table and his glass of wine and he was reading a book, and I said, wow, this isn't staged. This is real. And I think I just decided that here was somebody who I would always want to know. And I think that's when the first friendship developed. And then when I found out he was working on an eco-friendly, you know, collection, and there were coconut shells that he was using for earrings, that was like the final thing. I think that one made it to the cover, as did the Ash picture.
It was, yeah.
The Ash picture also made it to the cover. Denzel gave us some amazing shots in that whole collection. Yes, Denzel, you remember? I still have some of those pictures.
I don't think today we could ever put a photograph like this on the cover. Now you need a Dior bag, a Prada ring, and I don't know, Gucci shoes, whatever, because everyone is selling on those first few pages that you read in the magazine. That's all sold out, because those people are going to get their products on the cover.
Also the fact that it was black and white. I mean, I had an internal battle that you don't put black and white, you don't put without eye contact. But we managed it because it was an amazing picture.
Okay, the next two slides, you know, the green room sometimes becomes, it moves. I mean, we have to change the models. This is Malaika running down the hill in Kolwal. Normally, if we are doing this kind of a shoot, I have my my assistant Cheryl or my driver Vinay holding up these white bed sheets and changing the model in this open space. In this case, we didn't need to do anything. There were no need of any bed sheets because it was siesta time in Kolwal. So every villager was sound asleep and we were taking the photographs. This one and the next one, where, if you can jump please, the next one, I mean, I'm in the situation where you know Farooq always tells me, okay, dress the model up, then we throw her into position, then he says, can we lose the pants? So we lost the pants. Then finally we even lost the top, but we can't show you those photographs. And it all happens at 2 o'clock in the afternoon in Kolwal and the whole village is slumbering. Next slide please. And then this was my first big international debut internationally. I was so nervous because being the first Indian designer to be invited to the world's largest garment fair, I learned something which is called discipline. I mean, they told us 6 months in advance, send the clothes, send the look, whatever it is. And I'd never worked that much in advance. This is the great Helena Christensen, shot by an even greater Mario Testino, who shot all the photographs of Princess Diana and hundreds of covers still today. It was shot in Barbados, and it was only when I landed in Dusseldorf and I saw the entire city plastered with my photographs that I realized, okay, now I'm into the big league. And Satya Saran played a very wicked trick on me. Before I left, she said, can you write a piece on how to dress large women? And I did. And when I came back from India, from Megiddo, she had put it on the cover, introducing the Wendell Rodericks column. And I was trapped then into writing. Next week. And going international, this was also I was the first Indian designer to be invited to the Paris Pret-a-Porter Salon. I called the collection Goa Spa, and my partner Jerome, was sitting somewhere in the back and hiding, was completely mortified in that green room because I said, listen, these are the numbers, okay? We have 28 garments and the models will come to you and ask you for their garment and you give them the numbers, and Jerome tagged all the garments very neatly. But then finally the choreographer said, okay girls, change time, trial time, and all the girls stripped down to nothing except their G-strings, and Jerome was surrounded by this big cloud of bodies saying number 12, number 13, number 1, and I don't think he ever saw that many naked women in one room. Next, this is for the first India Fashion Week. This is our local beauty, Valusha D'Souza. It was in 2000, and we actually, Farooq went backstage and took these photographs. I don't think he'd ever do a job as menial as this now, to go backstage and take photographs. But at that time it was a big thing. I mean, this was the first India Fashion Week, which I was part of, being a consultant to Lakme. And I actually convinced Simone Tata and Ani Chopra that we should do this week and to take Indian fashion forward.
In fact, there's a very lovely chapter in the book on Shall We Do Fashion Week. The whole thing was discussed and almost finalized on the steps of what, the Met Museum?
Of the New York State Library.
Okay, the New York State Library. And it's so amazing how such big things come out of, you know, tiny little ideas which are just discussed off the cuff. Also at Fashion Week, I think this was something that set a trend. Today at every Fashion Week, big, small, medium, whether it's Lakme Wills India, there's a separate team that shoots backstage. I mean, the photographers are there for in front of the stage and backstage. And I think it goes to Farooq and Wendell that they set that trend.
And the next slide is from the same backdrop. This is Bipasha Basu in the early days. And the next one is Deepanita Sharma, which actually we got an ad based on this photograph, but we'll come to that later. The next slide is my favorite collection. It's called Visionaire. I met Meher Castellino, introduced me to a blind professor in Bombay, and he said, you know, can you help us to make some t-shirts with Braille on it? And I said, how will I help you? He said, no, it's not going to help us at all, but just for the, you know, the average person to know what Braille looks like. So I changed tracks, and like I wrote in the green room, I asked him, I said, what, do you have any problem with dressing up or whatever? And he said, yes, we do. We have this amazing problem because you guys can see what you have in front of you, and you get confidence in 5 minutes of dressing up. Whereas we have to go and ask our, in this case his wife, and say, is this a grey shirt? Because he had sight when he was young. Is this a grey shirt? Is it a brown shirt? Whatever. And it went on because he knew he wanted to wear on that particular day a grey shirt with a dark blue pant or whatever it is. And he said it takes us about 35 minutes to 40 minutes to get dressed because we just make this cupboard into a mess. And I said, that's terrible. And I said, you know, I'm going to go back and I'm going to call you back and find out about what I can do to help you. After many trial and error, we went to Caritas here in Goa and asked them for a braille sheet, which they took on photocopy. And we, I wrote in small French knots on one fabric and in small seed pearls on another. I wrote the what I wanted to say in braille. And I sent it to Professor Acharya. He says, I can't read it. You know, you guys who have sight, you can read the letter A as small as an ant or as tall as a building. I can't read this. So I said, okay, fine. So we went back to Caritas. We got an actual sheet where they typed out on the typewriter all the alphabets from A to Z and all the numbers from 1 to 10. And we then translated that onto two fabrics and we sent it to him. And he called me up very excited. In those days, he had no mobiles. He said, Wendell, I can read. And I teased him. I said, what does it say, Professor Acharya? He says, it says the Wendell Rodericks Visionaire Collection, white shirt, size medium. And since Helen Keeler, nobody had ever thought of putting braille on fabric. We got a lot of international applause for that collection. And lots of blind people from all over the world. I went on radio stations, TV stations in New York and Paris and London, telling me about how, like, you know, what I had done. And they kept on putting now braille in all the blind schools. They tell you to put braille on your, from the socks to the underwear. It was all done because of this collection. I'm a blind model. And I said, how can you model when you're blind? And she said, I can calculate by the echo of my feet. I know where the edge of the ramp is. And she said, when I reach head ramp, by the amount of light that's falling on my face, I know that I've reached head ramp. And I thought that was quite amazing that she could do that. Anyway, we did this for a social cause, but the good thing is that, yeah, sorry, go ahead.
I want to add that the story of the Visionaire Collection didn't end there. I mean, yes, there are now a lot of schools, blind, schools for blind children who use braille in the clothing, but recently there was an event at the Taj Bombay where Dr. Agarwal came to create awareness about retinal problems. He started this NGO called Retina India, and he says the cornea is something that can be replaced and everybody is aware of it. But the retina, when you have a retinal defect, it's almost something you can't do anything about, and he, they are trying to create awareness, build up a fund to help such people with deficiencies or injured retinas. And there, in fact, when he asked me, who is the person who can help us, I said, yeah, Wendell, Dr. Wendell. He did a whole collection of braille garments. And I think Wendell was, and Jerome were unfortunately not in India. But their collection landed up there. And I'm sure it will now go to the next level.
Okay, we did this for a social cause, but then we made a lot of money because in the next slide you'll see that that hand position of Malaika was liked by the people in Switzerland where we did the Breguet ad. It's very strange, you know, you go to Paris and you're the only brown-skinned person in the room styling the model, and you have all these international people. I mean, this is an Indian model, so we were two of us. But it's a great high because you suddenly realize that I'm going from the small village in Goa to the main life in Paris and actually shooting these ads, which is going to be a campaign that's going to appear in Time Magazine and Newsweek, etc. The next slide, the next two slides, is a collection. Is actually, we may sometimes we have these fun shoots. I mean, this is Farooq and me shooting Ujwala Raut in Jimmy Gazwa's house again. And we did this collection, but it was the base of a collection that was called Tribes of India or Tribes of the World. And Satya remembers that, right? The Rurai.
Actually, that was absolutely magical event We had all of us sailing on the down the Mandovi, and then we stopped in at this house. What's the name of the house?
Sonadukulas.
Yeah, which in fact I kept telling him, I'll never forget that ride. We must go on another boat ride like that. and Ujwala story. Should I share Ujwala story? Well, Ujwala today is a supermodel, but when she first came to us, it was very much like Mahajasya's story. Different. And Ujwala plays a huge important part in your book too, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. You have to read how she faced the camera for this. But when she did come to us, she didn't even speak English. And she came without a swimsuit. I mean, the swimsuit she had, you couldn't look at her in it because it had long legs and stuff like that. She had to borrow a swimsuit for the audition. And she came with her makeup in a biscuit tin and was rejected, was completely rejected. And somewhere, you know, I mean, when you're a woman, you feel sorry for another woman. So I told her, just come tomorrow and I'll take you for an editorial shoot. I'm sure we can do something with you. 2 days later she came, and she came looking like a princess. She had borrowed a gown from some friend of hers, a designer friend. She put her hair up, she looked like Audrey Hepburn. And again I went running down and said, we have to take her into Look of the Year because she has it, she has the carriage with me. And then of course she had to learn to walk, she had to learn to speak. But then here she is.
I think she was the third Look of the Year, right? After Shamin Shani.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, but it was a great success story. I mean, now she's great friends with people like Tom Ford and everybody in that fashion scene in New York. The next slide, this green room, this was my second Lakme finale. It was called Water Spray. And this model was so nervous. Her name is Firoz Gujral. And now she's a big model. But Firoz Gujral had just won the Gladrax contest. And I remember Maureen Vadia sitting in the audience and saying, are you going to put that girl to open your show? I said, yes. She said, but she has thick thighs. And I said, listen, I'm not bothered about her thighs. Everyone's going to look at her torso. Because we made this water kind of an aquarium corset. And she had to wear nothing underneath. So I was actually in the green room sticking sequins on her breast and all to kind of, you know, deflect the light. And she was very nervous. And she said, are you sure you want me to do this? We actually got those bubbles, you know, which they find at fairs, blown up and put in their hair. And when she came out, the audience gasped because the water kept moving and sloshing around into that corset. And she was naked underneath. And I told her, I said, tomorrow morning you will be famous. She did, because the photograph appeared on every single newspaper the next day. Next, please. And this is a young girl called Elna Rustamji. The reason why I put this in was, sometimes the green room happens in strange places. Like this is an old mill in Bombay called Mukesh Mills. And there's a story in my book about how Delna Rustamji, she was a ballet dancer, how she came after the shoot, and there was another model for the afternoon section. She came into the shoot with my friend Sridevi, and we sat in this taxi. And my very rustic Hindi, we had to pick up another friend of mine called Maya. And I told the taxi fellow, I mean, in English it sounded simple. I said, we need to pick up another girl. So I said, yahan roko, aur ek ladki ko uthana hai. But I mean, when he saw me with this girl completely painted up, he thought that, you know, now this guy is some Arab guy, you know, sleeping with some colorful girl from the local area. And when Maya stepped, of course, Delna walks out of the taxi and goes to the Taj Mahal Hotel with all this makeup on. And Maya stepped in, and then after 5 minutes, she said, why is this taxi driver looking at me so strangely? Okay, next. In the same, that mill, by the way, is haunted. Okay, Bibhasha Basu refused to shoot there because one spirit caught her hair and was pulling her. And the next slide is, we shot Malaika Arora in that same mill. It was a very strange shoot. If you can go to the next slide, please. Where we did this very dramatic setting where Farooq sat this horse. I wanted that horse to be a unicorn, you know, and put a horn on him. And this with this very sexy girl at the side, but the horse refused to have this thing strapped to him. It almost kicked me in all the wrong places. And so we had to abandon that. I said, can we Photoshop it? Can we put a horn on it? But no. So this is the final shot, but it was a 2003 hot list of dresses.
I want to say, talking of the green room, that the green room can really be everywhere and anywhere, besides being a great book. And one of the green rooms that I experienced was when we were shooting Madhu Sapre. She had just come back from Miss Universe after just missing the crown by a hair's breadth, and we were shooting her for one of our fashion features for Garden. And we went to paint, And we shot over there because we wanted those Ganpatis being made at that point. And we had shot 6 shots, we needed 2 more. We were heading back when the makeup man decided to change the lipstick. And he took his own time over it, and the sun was going down, and the golden light that you get. And the photographer said, "I need this light, I need this light." And she was still in the earlier garment. So in the middle of the highway, we held 2 saris and made her change. With trucks going on either side, and we shot, we got that shot finally.
Okay, and the next slide is, I don't know if you recognize her because she had a lot of work done later. This is the very early photograph of a girl called Rima Lamba, who later morphed and bought her way a sexy body and is now called Malika Sharawat. Next, please. Malika Sharawat. This was shot in Farooq's studio again. Farooq's green room is a tiny, if you can call it kitchen, I'd rather call it a bathroom, which has space for one fridge and one model. But we shot the most beautiful girls in that studio. It was a very lucky studio in Churchgate, and now it has gone to Baikala to Denzel's. Next, please. And this is one green room which I will never forget in all my life. It was at the Goa Marriott Resort, and I did an entire show where the green room was on stage, which the tailors actually stitching the clothes on stage and sending them out. Till today, when I hear that music of Remo from India Beyond, I get nervous, and I don't think I'll ever do a show like that again, because it was such a difficult show to do, because the models were on the stage changing, and we sent them out and they changed their personality on the pool. Next, please. These are all from the same ramp. This dress caused a big noise, because Nina Manuel, it was a kind of, one of those pop-up children's books that open up and you get those little buildings that come up. And Nina Manuel, actually she closed the, it was closed, that flower that you see, it's a 3D kind of pop-up flower. And we had to move it to one side. Of course, by the time she moved it over, she exposed one breast, which made its way to the HH. Next, please. And this was Lakshmi Menon's first ever catwalk. She became a huge model and is today known and revered by many people all over the world. The next slide, she actually, this came in Femina, right?
Yeah, that's it. In fact, this picture made her career, I think, after that. And I must have discovered a lot of famous models, and Wendell is one of the people responsible. You haven't spoken enough of that in your book. You should do another book now about the models that have come out of war. And I remember when we were doing a book for a French writer, the pictures they wanted of models, they all wanted only Lakshmi Menon.
But she became the face of Hermes and
absolutely,
many other campaigns.
Yeah.
In the next slide, we'll see the actual photograph that appeared on the cover. It was a bandage dress. I still remember the opening garment. She appeared naked on that ramp. And I wound the bandages around her. I don't know whether you remember. It was garment number 1. And then that made it to the cover of Femina. Sometimes, like we see in the next slide, the beach becomes the green room. This is a girl called Maria Andrea. She was a winner of the MTV model contest. We shot it in the Seychelles, a great holiday, because actually there's only one flight to go to the Seychelles from Bombay. And we would fly in over there on one day, and then we were obliged to stay till the next Friday. And then, because the son of the president of the country fell in love with Malaika, they gave us a helicopter. Then we finished our shoot in 2 days. And we went and saw all the islands. This is one of the most beautiful beaches in the world. It's called La Digue. And La Digue is, till today, the most beautiful beach, voted time and time again. Next is Lisa Ray. This was shot on Zeebob at Uttorda. Again, this whole thing is shot early in the morning with bed sheets and whatever to protect that magnificent body. Next slide. This is Nicole Faria, who won Miss Earth. She was a Femina Miss India winner. This was shot at Vagathor Beach. I still remember we had to reach the beach at 5 o'clock in the morning to make sure that we did not have any public on the beach. And then by the time the sun rose and it started to rise, Nicole, finally, we got this shot and many other shots that appeared in Man's World, which is the next cover. Eventually, what we used for the cover was one coconut leaf. It was after a very long time. I told the editor, Raja, I said, you're the first magazine in the recent history. I don't know, I think it was 2011, where we actually had again no Dior ring, no Prada bag, no nothing. It was just one coconut leaf. And we continued this beach theme. In the next slide, you'll see Lakshmi Menon, where we did international advertisements. This was done for Swatch Bijou. Again, it would shock me. You know, we shot the ad in the Seychelles and whatever it is, and then you go to New York and you see it on Times Square, blown up 7 stories, 20 stories high. And then you say, God, we did it. I mean, I did it, as Wendell Rodericks says, you know, this Goan boy living in Kolwal. And we did a lot of ads. The next one is also what we shot in dry foods, Aishwarya Rai for Longines.
That is the palace, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the Rambagh Palace.
Yeah, which reminds me of a story about Gayatri Devi, which also tells you that shoots all over the world are very hit and miss. I had done an interview of Gayatri Devi for Vogue Germany, and I didn't know I was going to be doing that interview for Vogue Germany till she had flown off to London. So by the time they told me you have to interview her, I had to follow her, spend my own money, follow her and do that interview in London. And that's when I realized that they were also shooting her. Lord Lichfield was shooting her. And somewhere between German Vogue and British Vogue, they goofed up. And Gayatri Devi was sitting there, Lichfield was sitting there, and there was no makeup person. And Gayatri Devi said, okay, if there's no makeup person, I don't shoot. I'm going back. And she's 80 plus, okay? So you don't fool around with that kind of a age or that kind of a Maharani or Rajmata. So finally, they pulled strings at the last minute, and then when the makeup woman came, she said, all I want is lipstick. So that's how they shot her.
Yeah, sometimes what happens is that the green room is no other
green room that you can ever control. Sometimes the green room...
Sometimes the green room is not what we want to control. In the next slide, you'll see we have to constantly steal girls. You know, they are doing this is for Blenders Pride fashion tour. I had to drag like Lisa Hayden and say, I have my New Year's card to send out, and can you come and pose for me? And then she would drop everything. We would take her out from the rehearsal, beg Alison Kanuga and say, can I please take her because I have to shoot this thing? And that green room then becomes actually the green room of somebody else's green room. But we bring her to Vishesh Varma's studio and shoot her. Next slide, please. Which eventually became the cover, the New Year card. And the next one as well, this is Kanishta, again stolen from the Blenders Pride green room. Anyone here from Blenders Pride, please excuse me. And the next one, we actually took Moni Kangana Dutt into the men's urinal and shot her there. And the next one, okay, this is Carol Gracious meditating before my show. I think she was in pain. They don't have another wardrobe malfunction because she was the person that was responsible for that malfunction that was, you know, spread all over every newspaper. The poor girl, I mean, she did say that this halter neck needs to have a hook. But the designer did not listen to her and put a Velcro piece. Naturally, when she walked halfway out the ramp, the Velcro piece came undone and her breasts were exposed to the entire world. You have something to say about that?
Yeah, I have something to say to that. And I think you've dealt with it wonderfully in your book, Wendell. But the fact remains that I remember I was aghast at the fact that every newspaper, every magazine spoke only about them. Not about anything else, not about the clothes, not about the fact that that particular designer had horrendous clothes and shouldn't have been showing in the first place. But only about the fact that, yes, something went wrong. And just to tell you that Carol always meditates before a show. And she has the most beautiful voice. Sometimes, if you want to have some great music from some unexpected sources, you should listen to Carol.
I met her actually at as a group of a choir in a Bandra crowd. And that's how I knew her before she became famous. Okay, the next set of slides, we'll go through this quickly. These are the green room slides. I do not know whether you can see, but Indrani Dasgupta sitting on two chairs. This happens very often. Sometimes they're sitting on five chairs. And please go on. This is from the green room at the Kunmi tribe collection for the sari that I revived, which is thankfully sitting with Sonia Gandhi and the ex-president Pratibha Patil, and in the White House with Michelle Obama. This is the green room at there. Can you see that small table on the right hand side here in this slide? That is what we call the final makeup table. Before the girls go out, they're all standing in line to go on ramp. They have this table that's always there in the green room, which is the final makeup, spray, whatever, touch up, which goes on just before they step on. Next slide, please. And then this is the Kunti Sari, which finally came on stage. This is our Noina. And the next one is Lisa Ray, who actually posed with the sari, and we got. I'm happy to say that the Goa government, after much prodding, has started weaving again in Goa. We have the Home Science College, who started a weaving course for the students and will be open to the public by May 2013, where we are going to introduce weaving to the state of Goa again. It's about 100 years after they stopped weaving the Kunbi sari. And I'm very proud of that. And this is my book, Moda Goa. There's no green room involved here, but we do have something. Prajal Sakandar is right in this room. Next slide, please. Who took me to all around Goa to show me stuff. And sometimes we needed to photograph items which were done. Next slide. Which were done. Sometimes, you know, I needed a model, but I just wanted to show the beauty of our Goan jewelry. And I had to actually hold it in my hand. This is shot by the very young and talented Mark Sequeira, who helped me through the entire book. And the next slide as well. These are really big pieces of jewelry. This is Pallavi Dempo's earrings. One is in my hand and the other is on the table next to me. And sometimes we actually had to use people in the house, like in the next slide, to show this wonderful Morni peacock hair ornament, where we would take anybody in the house. This was shot by Bharat Ramamurtam. I think it was on his then girlfriend, now wife, Moni, who actually had to wear Mohandas Naik's jewelry and sari. Wife, sorry, not his. Next, please. And this is what we have backstage. This is a collection sheet where we line it up and paste it for the models. We do it in sections depending on the scene. Those little small musical notes are music changes. And those change according to how the scene is going. So the first is like 10 people with all the models' names written on it. This we paste just behind the green room so the models can know their entry. Next, please. And then this is my final last collection, which was, we did a collection called Ocean Orient. This is the last set of slides. Ocean Orient was about an imaginary voyage going from Goa to Shanghai. And I had the chance to again explore 8 Goan garments, 8 Malakan garments, and about 12 Chinese garments. That is Jojo, the hair and makeup person. First we discuss the look and then the girls are getting ready. Next slide, please. This is all of them sitting down over there. And next slide. We do them in different batches and they always have this hideous food to eat. I don't know why they don't have salads. It's always a pizza or a sandwich. That is the lovely Tamara Moss sitting backstage and having a lunch. Next, please. This was a makeup that was done for the show. They normally do the eyes first after foundation and do the lips and the blusher last, which is the next slide. The blusher section and the next one. The hair goes on somewhere last or whatever. And when the girl is finally made up, they bring her to me and say, can we, you know, is it okay? And finally, we put on the nail polish, which is always programmed as to which one is going with which girl and which shoe. Next, please. Next. Okay, constant tweaking of the look, I mean the hundreds of looks in the mirror that go on in the green room. And then at the back we also have a photographer who actually takes the photographs of the clothes before they enter the ramp. And these are glamour photographs that we can use later. As you can see in the next one, Jessie Randhawa opened the show. But she's posing for a Danish photographer who we have still to use the photographs because the show just got over 2 months ago. The next one. This is rehearsal time, where the girls plan the rehearsal. It happens exactly half an hour before the show starts. It's incredible that it actually happens only half an hour because they have to learn the walk and the music and the re-entry, which is the next one. We make them plan the re-entries again and again. And we take about 20 minutes and the rehearsal is done. Next, please. This is the final lineup where we have to place all the models and tell them where to stand before I enter. And the final... So then, I did the Goan garments. This is the kashti. People said, who's going to buy that and who's going to wear it? And Alisha Chennai bought it and said, I'm going to wear it with silver leggings for my next music video. That's Jessie Randhawa wearing the Goan kashti. And the next one is inspired by the Pan Baju, but all done in modern contemporary style. And the next one is inspired by the Kimao, or a kind of a Chinese coat. And I think the next one, that's it.
Before we close this, I just want to ask you one question, which I'm sure is in everybody's mind here. Before that, before I hand it over to the audience, is that you've done two books which are very, very different. One is, of course, your life, and the other is something that you had to research. How does it feel to operate on those two different levels, and how does it connect to what you do as a designer?
The first book actually I wrote, Moda Goa, I wrote out of a sense of research, because Mario Miranda told me to write an article on the Pan Baju, which Mario Cabral was coming up with a book. The book never saw the light of day, but actually when I studied the Pan Baju, I realized that there was a history behind these Goan clothes, and nobody had ever documented it, not on a national level, not on a state level. And I said, you know, I'm a designer, I teach world costume history, I think I can write this book. I set off on a journey that was very long, actually. I went, I even had to intern in two museums, the National Costume Museum in Lisbon for 3 months and the museum at FIT in New York, to learn about how to preserve clothes. I now have a collection, a very large collection of old Goan clothes. I've been buying jewelry, I've been buying shoes, I've been buying anything that's Goan, because I will have a museum one day on the history of Goan costume. But that book, the Moda Goa book, which it took 11 years of my life, and I'm glad I wrote it, because I think it's a legacy where we see the history of our state through clothes. As far as Green Room was concerned, Venita Coelho, who may or may not be here, was a part of Goa Writers, and she threw a challenge. Vivek was there and said, you know, we should write a book in 2 months, 60,000 words a month, 2,000 words a day. And I think I was the only one who completed the task. And then I'd still not finished my story, so I wrote for another 2 months, drove everybody mad, starting with my partner Jerome in our house, going through albums and photographs and agendas and calling the office, and almost Nazi-like, you know, saying, give me this information because I have to go. And I finished the book actually in 4 months, and I'm glad that they both saw the light of day this year. It's been a great year for me. In 2012, I came out with two books, one in January at the Jaipur Lit Fest, and the other at Lakme Fashion Week in August.
And I must say that, like everything else you do, both books have their place in history. I mean, there's no way anyone's going to let you forget those books or forget the book themselves. If there are any questions, we'd love to take them.
I have a question. Wendell, are you working on another book now?
I'm working on two books.
Anyway, what do you think sets you apart from the average Goan boy in a small village? What is the spark that drove your success?
I really don't think about myself, or I don't think about that person that is in the newspapers or on television. I just do whatever I can do and really enjoy myself. I mean, Satya has been staying with me for 3 days, and she can vouch for the fact that I lead a very, very simple life. I lead a very normal life. I wake up at 5:30 every morning and I start working. And I choose very selectively where to go out. I don't do page three often. I don't party like other designers do. And I know that if I put good clothes on the rack in all the cities of India and they sell, I think I've done my job. I don't need to do any more PR or anything else. And I'm saying it again, I really don't think of myself. I don't think that I'm Wendell Rodrigues or whatever. That is what the media created, and that is, I remember Satya first coined this phrase, guru of minimalism. And I'm still recovering from the fact that I have to live up to that constantly. But I really give my best to everything I do. It's 100% focus. Even when I'm doing a collection, I don't go out, I don't go for dinners, I don't go for lunches. I just stay with that collection in my head and go to my studio every single day and work really hard on it till I finish that collection. And it's only then that I let loose.
You know, it makes a difference when someone is well known. And, you know, there are lots of us who are protesting about many things, but nobody listens. But once you're a face and you're a name, then suddenly everyone reports it. And it has some impact. I think that's why you think this happened recently.
I want to solve the garbage problem. That's my resolution for 2013. That we get Mr. Parikar to, you know, solve that issue, because we are really looking at a dump.
Well, thank you very much, Wendell and Satya, for a wonderful session capping a very long day. And thank you very much for being here. It's really a privilege. Very proud of Wendell and these two books that he's released.